Well, hi guys, it's that time. It's our Bible teaching snippet of the day. Well, I'm having a lot of internet problems, okay guys, and I'm going to try my very best to get this recorded and uploaded today. Today, what I want to do is go back to yesterday's teaching, okay, and I want to connect it and dig a little deeper, okay? If you recall, yesterday I had some stuff pulled up and I lost my internet and I couldn't read those scriptures to you. I also had an article and I had some stuff marked on it that I wanted to integrate in my teaching to clarify what I was going to teach. So with that said, today what I'm going to do is do a part two to this, and hopefully I can pull it all together for you, okay? Now, if we go back to about, you know, a week or so ago, I was on this little mini-series where I named it Faithful Questioning. It would be so easy for me to name yesterday and today's teaching Faithful Questioning because it kind of merges into and connects to what I was already teaching about those little ministry cards where you got to go out and tell people that they're sinners, they're separated from God, they're going to go to hell, they've got to say a sinner's prayer, they've got to get saved, they got to accept Jesus as Savior, and all of that. And this kind of hits on that same subject. Is all of that true? And this subject here, is it just God's wishful thinking that all men would be saved, but God is actually not powerful enough, and neither was Jesus victorious enough to see God's desire come true? So I want to go back and talk about this today. Today what I'm going to do is I'm going to read out of his article, the article that I quoted just two or three lines out of. I posted that after I posted my snippet yesterday, okay? So if you want to read that entire article, please do. It's very good. I'm not going to read it here on Facebook because it'll take 14 or 15 minutes to read that, okay? But I am going to read some of his paragraphs to mine out what I was teaching yesterday as well about 1 Timothy 2:4 as well as even 2 Peter 3:9. I've also pulled up those scriptures that I wanted to read to you yesterday, and I lost those when I lost my internet signal as well. So that's what I'm going to do. I'm going to pull this together today for you, okay? And I'm going to do it all in under 15 minutes. Okay, so here we go. I'm going to read the scripture to you the way it reads in most Bibles, okay? 1 Timothy 2:4, God desires that all men be saved and come to a knowledge of the truth. And also 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slow about his promise, as some count slowness, but is patient towards you, not wishing for any to perish, but for all to come to repentance. Now, I'm going to read from his article now. The only problem is that these verses are so direct about God's will to save all of humanity that translators have had to soften the wording in order to prevent confusion. Yes, translators are biased, and many translate certain verses in ways that better support their doctrinal position and the position of those they hope will purchase their specific translation. I know that probably sounds offensive, but we are a gullible generation, and nobody likes the idea that the ideas that they put their trust in might possibly be wrong. I am not saying that the scriptures are wrong, but that some of our English translations of scriptures, of these scriptures, are not entirely accurate. And I'm going to agree with him about that. I have found that he is 100% spot on what he's talking about. Different denominations, different groups of men, they walk into their translations with certain viewpoints and beliefs, and it affects what words they use and how they structure the sentences so it sounds like what they want you to believe, because that's what they believe. They're only human, guys, okay? So here we go. Let me pick back up on his statement. But don't worry, I won't expect you to take my word for it. I'm actually going to show you how the Greek in these verses actually communicates something very different. To begin with, when we read these verses, what we hear is God wishes that all men would be saved, but that probably is not actually going to happen. That's what I was taught, and I'm going to give you a confession. I've taught it that way, but I've repented, and I do not believe that. I believe it's right the opposite. These scriptures are saying that God is going to get what he wants I think about the song, I'm going to get you one way or another. God is going to get you. He loves you with such passion, He is never going to give up. Let me get back to the article. God wishes that all men would be saved, but that probably is not actually going to happen. The way we perceive these verses is as a kind of wishful thinking, a nice way of letting us know that He truly does want to help all those poor, lost, helpless souls out there. But His hands are tied. He can't help us because He's left it all up to us, right? Fortunately, that's not true. And He's right, it's not true. He didn't leave it up to Adam for Adam to get saved. He didn't leave it up to anybody to get themselves saved. He had a plan, and He worked with His Son Jesus, and they worked that plan, and they were victorious. And now, Jesus is absolutely the Savior of the whole world. Jesus is the Savior of all mankind, including those of us who believe, especially those of us who are believers. Okay, let me get back to his article. You see, translating that word as desire makes it sound passive. In English, it is employed as a noun, but the Greek word is actually a verb. The difference between a noun and a verb is that one is passive and one is active. Verbs convey action and their fundamental definition. And that is their fundamental definition, their action, not passive, they're active. Okay, the Greek definition of that word, desire, thelo, T-H-E-L-O, is to purpose, generally based upon a preference and a desire, to purpose. It denotes action, purpose, intent. It is not wishful thinking. A better translation is God intends to save all men and to bring them to a knowledge of truth. You know, that word truth in some translations is capital T, meaning that He's going to bring them to a knowledge of Jesus. Okay, here we go. We're going to move over to 2 Peter of that scripture, okay? Peter declares that the Lord does not wish, bolomea is the word, that any would perish, but for all to come to repentance. Again, the force of it conveys our English, in our English, is very weak. The Greek word bolomea means to think with the purpose of planning or deciding on a course of action, to purpose, to plan, to intend. Once again, we have the same issue. Our English translation softens the force of the Greek. The Greek word bolomea, like thelo, is also a verb denoting action. It also carries with it the implication of a plan by which to accomplish that specific will. And he denotes the lexicon that he has used to get these meanings from. It's the Lou and Nadi, N-I-D-A, Nadi, or Nade. Okay, let's keep moving. So a possible translation could be something along these lines, and I like the way he wrote this. The Lord is not slow about His promise, as some count slowness, but is patient toward you. His plan is that none will perish, but all will come to repentance. Now, he has some more that he talks about. Does Scripture support a God who retains the right to do according to His own will? And he says there are many very clear scriptures that directly state this, as well as a plethora of verses that imply it. Here's but a sampling. I've got four of them for you. God works all things after the counsel of His own will, Ephesians 1:11. My purpose will be established, and I will accomplish all my good pleasure. Isaiah 46:10. When I look at that and it says, I'll accomplish my good pleasure, go over to Ephesians chapter 1, verse 4 through 8 and see if it doesn't say that it was God's good pleasure for us to all be adopted as sons and daughters through Jesus. That good pleasure is right there linked in. Let me keep going. Whatever the Lord pleases, He does in heaven and in the earth, in the seas and in all the depths. Psalms 135:6. He, God, does according to His will in the host of heaven and among the inhabitants of the earth, and no one can ward off His hand. Daniel 4:35. Okay, here's his conclusion. God declares His will and His plan is to save all men, and He declares that He works all things out according to the counsel of His own will. then we can be absolutely certain that is exactly what is going to happen, especially in light of his sworn oath to save all men in Isaiah 45, verse 22 and 23. Okay, now that's everything that I wanted to share with you with him and his article. For the rest of my time, I'm going to give you the scripture references that bring this together and start showing you what God's plan and what God's will is, and that he absolutely did accomplish what he wanted to through his son Jesus. I'm going to read you Acts 3:20 in the Passion Translation. "And he will send you Jesus, the Messiah, the chosen one for you. For he must remain in heaven until the restoration of all things has taken place, fulfilling everything that God said long ago through his holy prophets." I'm going to read you those footnotes. It says here that in Acts 3:21, until the time of universal restoration, that means a complete renewal and restoration of all of his entire creation. Here's another footnote. "This is the one the heavens must receive until the time of universal restoration." The word restoration in the Greek is apokatesis, something like that, which infers the restoration of creation to the state of existence before the fall. The next thing I want to pull out here, it says the Greek word found here, only here in the New Testament, the apokatesis in the New Testament, is noteworthy. It is a medical term that means restoration of perfect health. Now, I'm going to rip you out some scriptures really quick, and then I'll post these in the video underneath so you can just look them up for yourself. Luke 2:10. Jesus is good news to all people, not some people, all people. John 3:35 and 12:47, Jesus is the Savior of the world, not part of the world. 1 John 4:14, the Father has sent his Son to be the Savior of the world. See, he's going to drop a net over the entire world, all of creation, all of mankind, and drag us all back into his kingdom, out of the kingdom of darkness. Okay, let's keep going. 1 John 2:2. Jesus is the atoning sacrifice for our sins, and not only for ours, us Christians, but for the sins of the whole world. Yeah, that's a bold statement. 2 Corinthians 5:19. It was God personally present in Christ, reconciling and restoring the world to favor with himself, not counting up and holding against men their trespasses, but canceling them out and committing to us the message of reconciliation, the restoration of favor. 1 Corinthians 15:22. For just as in Adam all, A-L-L, die, also in Christ all will be given life. See, it's a balancing. What Adam did, Jesus undoes it and does it better. Okay, Romans 5:18. So as one sin of Adam brought the punishment of death to all people, so too one good act that Christ did makes all people right with God, bringing them to life. Okay? Now, I would suggest also that you just read all of Romans chapter 5, verse 12 through 19, because it's very clear that one man's disobedience, okay, caused the human race to enter into death, but through one man, Jesus, his obedience, the entire world was made righteous. Okay, but listen, I'm going to sign off here, and I pray that this teaching has come together for you. And again, I have many, many more scriptures. I have a list of scriptures that I will be happy to send to anyone that desires to study this subject a little bit deeper. I'm going to sign off. I love you, and I will see you here next week. Bye-bye.